everyone, and welcome back to my channel. Usually when I film like a sit down chatty video on a certain topic, I usually use my microphone like this. I'm using this microphone today. I hope that the audio is okay. If you prefer the audio on my other videos, just let me know, because I think these microphones can be a bit temperamental. When I hold it, there's loads of noise going on, whereas when I clip it to myself, I sound muffled. So I'm hoping that you can hear me okay. If not, we're going to have a big issue, because I'm not about to get up and check again, because I've done that about 20 times. Some of my videos, I do loads of research, and that's good, but sometimes it can take away from my stories, my experiences, and just me, you know? And today I wanted to talk about the topic relationship breakdowns or relationship issues. It goes without saying that I am not a complete beacon of knowledge to the extent where I am all-knowing and I'm all-powerful. I'm not only a trainee. I have certain lived experiences that other people might not have. I don't have kids, all of those different things. So I always find it important to preface my videos with that before I begin, because my perspective, when I'm not talking about theory, not that all theories encapsulate all different norms, because some of them really don't at all, but when I'm talking from my experience, it goes without saying, like, it's my experience and it's not everyone's. So I just wanted to really emphasize that at the beginning of this video. I have not planned, nor have I prepared for this video. I've got a few points that I want to talk about, but this is all just coming out, coming to you. And yeah, I hope that you guys find it useful. If you like this style of content, make sure to give this video a like so that I know to keep making it. I think we can all name experiences where we have felt a complete breakdown in the relationship. And I think it's unbelievable how many reasons this could happen for. Difference in moral values and opinions, arguments, someone not seeing from your perspective, someone always thinking they're right. The biggest message that I want to give in this video is that conflict is okay. And I had a conversation with my friend, my boyfriend's sister. I call her my friend because she's my friend. Shout out Deborah, Debate Books. Go follow her on YouTube. We had a conversation earlier about, well, she sent me a video on psychology, and it was this kind of vibe where this man, I don't know if he's a psychology student or whatnot, but this video ignited some sort of reaction in me that I wanted to just talk about. And it's something I've wanted to talk about. It will make sense why I've referenced that in a minute. Somewhere I wanted to talk about this. Now, I want to invite all of you right now. I want you guys to, if you feel comfortable, if you want to, think about your relationship with conflict. Do you like arguing? Do you enjoy it? Do you like getting a rise in people? Can I just preface this with, there is no judgment. There is no judgment on my channel. You know, obviously everyone judges subconsciously and unconsciously, blah, blah, blah. But if we recognize that maybe we're a person that does that, that's okay. There's no judgment. So we need to, it's a given that we leave our judgment at the door when we sit together and I talk and you watch and you comment and we interact like that. There is no judgment. So if there's certain responses that we have towards conflict that you think, I don't want to own up to that, this is a safe space. Sometimes when we get caught up in self-reflection, it can be a scary place, because sometimes we do realize things about ourselves. We uncover those blind spots, which are actually a bit like, oh, I don't really like the way that I do that, but that's okay. There's no judgment. So back to my point. Let's think about how we communicate, how we deal with conflict. Do we enjoy conflict? Like I said, getting a rise out of people. Do we avoid conflict? Why I'm mentioning this, like when people think about conflict, they think about arguments and they don't want to have arguments. Or there's the other point where people have the arguments and they're the catalyst, but the argument is not productive. So when I talk about a productive argument, I'm talking about something that blows up, maybe bad things are said, but overall we have this conclusion of like you're understanding more of each other in the relationship and all is grand, is growth. Whereas when we think about the opposite of that, which is an argument which ends in the relationship breaking down even more, we don't have that space for rupture and repair. It kind of just ruptures and cracks and I would say that most situations, or a lot of situations, there can be a repair. When we experience like a rupture, that's what I mean by more of a negative like end to an argument. Regardless of, you know, let's obviously take that time, think about the way that you respond to conflict. Do you enjoy conflict? Do you shy away from conflict? Are you somewhere in the middle? Are you someone that is very defensive in conflict? What is your opinion on conflict? How do you think that you respond to conflict, like in general? Because I think, and when we understand our relationship with conflict and the way that we engage with that is really interesting. Now, I think when I talk about conflict, I'm feedback, I mean arguments, constructive criticism. When we think of that, I am quite good at giving feedback. I love having feedback and I'm good at giving feedback. We live in a society where conflict is frowned upon. My relationship with conflict, I thought that I was quite open to it. I thought that I was good at responding to conflict. What the subject matter is of the conflict like really matters to me. So if it's someone coming to me like, this piece of work is not good, you need to sort this out, hen, I'd be like, cool, thank you, no worries. If it's about something personal, for example, this is like kind of a cultural, I guess, thing that I'm referencing, but Big Brother, there was a man on there who was crying last night because he got referred to as boring. Now, if this feedback was maybe the fact that he didn't do enough around the house, you know, the fact that maybe, I don't know, something else, something a bit more superficial, like he would have taken that and not been so emotional. But this guy was called boring and he was so emotional over it. And don't get me wrong, being called boring is not a nice thing to be called. I mean, technically Levi didn't call him boring. The guy that called him boring technically didn't. He retracted whilst he was saying it. But anyway, this other guy took it really personally. The bottom line in what I'm saying is the way that it depends what conflict is presented to us, because if it plays on an insecurity that we've already got, or it comes from someone we really, really love, that's difficult. I would always say, especially in therapy, like the therapeutic relationship with a client, if I get something wrong, tell me, let's have a conflict, as it were. But there are differences when it comes to conflict that is maybe a bit more easy to have, and then conflict that just makes you feel so uncomfortable and it really touches a nerve. This is why even the people that invite positive conflicts is what I'm trying to represent in this video. It's not always easy. I think this leads me on to like, how do we have more positive, productive conflicts in our life? I think we have to think about me. So say me, I'm having a conflict with my boyfriend. Me and my boyfriend are having a conflict, okay? So we think about our environment. Where are we? Are we in a coffee shop? Are we on the phone? Is this the best place to have this conflict? To be honest with you, I'll stop your train of thought, which will potentially be happening maybe right now, which is, how am I supposed to predispose or like predispose? Is that predict? How am I meant to predict all these things? Sometimes conflicts just happen, especially like maybe on a night out, you know. But I think that when we think about what I'm about to explain, we can think about it in like a retrospective point of view. So if we realize that a lot of our arguments happen over text, a lot of our arguments happen with our partner, we don't tend to argue with our friends. Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? When we look back on our argument patterns and our conflict patterns, maybe we can then tailor, like subconsciously be aware of that in the future, so that we can maybe unravel some of that and allow the conflict to be more productive, because we're not in those environments where maybe things would get misconstrued, like on text messages or things like that. And then so we've spoken about the environment, let's talk now about the relationship. So when we think about the relationship between me, my partner, we're very close. So our arguments might knock each other really, really hard. That's okay. I think that when we really, really close with someone and we have an argument, naturally it's going to hurt a lot. And we have to accept that. But the whole thing about rupture and repair is that when we rupture and repair, it will overall strengthen that bond. This is what I'm kind of referring to as like a positive conflict or argument. So if we move on a little bit to like a negative argument, like do we blow up, go really defensive, start shouting? Do we meet our match? Maybe we have a personality trait that's really, really similar. Like, do you like conflict? Do you enjoy it? Why do you enjoy it? What is that saying about your relationships? What is that saying about the power that you hold over your relationships? Or maybe the power that you don't feel in your relationships. If you feel like you have to argue, maybe you have to feel like you have to get your foot in the door so that you have power when you usually feel powerless. You know, there's so many meanings. It's like a dream, like when, you know, psychoanalysis and psychoanalytical approaches try and analyze dreams, they don't all mean the same thing. Depending on a person's context and their story, the dream might mean different things. Over the past couple months, like 6 to 8 months, I've kind of been thinking about conflict as a positive thing. But the reality is, it's not always positive. And should we welcome conflict? Feedback? Yes. But it needs to be, well, it could be in an environment where that is facilitated and not, like, I think knowing to when to walk away is like the biggest skill ever, isn't it? But yeah, I don't know. And going back to, anyway, I've been questioning you in this video about your, like, the way that you react to conflict. My way is, depending on the subject matter, like, I can be really, really defensive. But a lot of the time I can be understanding. But usually with conflict, I get really, really overwhelmed. And that comes from my lack of self-confidence. And I think when I argue with someone, it is a complete knock on my confidence because it makes me feel, oh my God, like this is verifying, validating all of my insecurities that I had about myself. Just because that person is bringing forth to me something maybe that I did wrong or something that they didn't like that I said, blah, 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 doesn't mean that they're trying to round up my personality in one argument, unless they actually say that, which is a completely different thing. The more I talk about confrontation, conflict, feedback in this video, the more I feel like it's so like complicated. I think to end this video, I kind of wanted to talk about like welcoming all different parts of ourselves, because I think when we're in an argument, maybe sometimes we might shout, sometimes we might go silent, sometimes we might cry, sometimes we might understand. Maybe our quiet moment allows the other person to be a bit more shouty and a little bit, you know, so we're kind of taking turns in these blowouts and regulation between the two relationship partners and whatnot. Being defensive, being all of these things, we have the opportunity to be those things. And I think just because we might have an argument where we think, oh, I didn't really show up that great, I didn't put myself in a great position actually, you know, I did say a few mean things, like whatever it may be, forgive ourselves for that. And I think when we talk about rupture and repair in a relational sense, meaning more than one person, so me and my boyfriend, rupture and repair, we've ruptured, we've repaired, and we've grown. That can also work within ourselves, I think. If we have a rupture and we think, oh my gosh, I acted out, like, oh my goodness. Part of the repair might be an apology, self-reflection. And then the growth for ourselves is, how do we next time change that reaction? How do we, you know, modify it? And I think for a lot of people, they think, well, this is the world that I study in and blah, blah, blah. If we do that self-reflection, subconsciously, it will be within our behavioral response next time, because we've reflected and we've subconsciously worked through some things which will allow us to behave differently in the future. So it doesn't mean that mid-argument I'm like, okay, what did I learn last time? Let me change that. Do you know what I mean? That's not the vibe. The vibe is like, through the self-reflection, we're able to like act differently in the future because our subconscious is kind of facilitating that through the prior self-reflection. Cool. Sometimes there are ruptures that are not repaired. Now, this is something that I'll make another video about. Coming to an acceptance of a rupture and a finishing of a relationship, which happens all the time. It's not just boyfriends, girlfriends, friendships, work colleagues. It can be death, you know, like if you feel like there was a rupture, someone passed away, where's the repair? Like this can go really existential. This can go really like into the existential realm. And what do we do? What do we do when there is a rupture that isn't repaired? Or when there's a rupture that is just completely someone cutting you off and that's it? Because it's more so now, I'm finding that through speaking to people, like generally in my work, there are a lot of instances where people have come to me and said, like, my friend has just cut me off. Like, what do I do with this? And that's like a really difficult place to be. And that is a form, I guess, of conflict where it's kind of a silent conflict. And usually there's been no communication from that person who's cut the person off of why they're doing it. And sometimes it's not all of that person's fault. In a relationship, there's usually more than one person, right? So sometimes we can sit here and blame ourselves for arguments, for conflict. But there's two sides to every story. And similarly, if people think they're completely right, you know, you'd have that reaction. Oh no, there's another side to the story. So if you think you're completely wrong or you're completely right, there is an issue because we're not allowing that compassion or self-reflection retrospectively. I hope that you enjoyed listening to or watching this video, or let me know in the comments, have you ever had an experience where someone's ghosted you and you know, there was a rupture and there was no repair? How do you think that a rupture of a relationship can be repaired? What do you think are the key points? What are your ways of arguing? Are you a shouter? Do you slam doors? Or do you completely avoid it and go silent? There's no kind of, obviously what I wanted to say in this video, you know, what I said at the start of this video is there's no judgment. We all argue, we all get things wrong. There is no right or wrong unless you're, you know, making someone feel utterly terrible. That's more bullying and, you know, abusive, emotionally abusive relationships, which are not part of this video. Thank you so much for watching. I post 3 times a week on my channel. I'm nearly 1,000 subscribers. I would love to have you here. Again, this is a safe space for no judgment. And I hope maybe this found you at a time where you kind of maybe needed something to calm you down. I mean, arguments are just really, you know, really, really difficult. They are difficult when things get difficult in the argument. Conflict isn't always pretty. And I think that's something I definitely thought was the case for a long time. And now I'm like, no, it's not always okay. There's not always a constructive end to things. Sometimes things don't end well, and that's okay. It's just what we do with that and what that says about us or the people around us, or you know, how we're growing or how another person is growing at that moment in time. Thank you again so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Take care as always.